Celebrate, everybody, and welcome to the epic, awesome show, anime podcast number 220. I'm Zain, and unfortunately, I am alone today. So it is just little old me. Yay! So I'll try to be as, you know, as great as I can. Maybe you will want to listen to my soothing voice. Oh, yeah. Hopefully as the, you know, as this goes, you know, we'll be able to bring in more and more people. But as of right now, you know, it's just a little old eye. So let's talk a little bit. Let's kind of just dive into it here, shall we? Going into 2024 so far has been an absolutely solid year in anime. Between Frieren still going, Shangri-Ibra, Shangri-La, wow, Shangri-La Frontier being, you know, Shangri-La Frontier. A bunch of the new stuff that surprised me. The Wrong Way to Use Healing Magic has very much surprised me. MASHLE, the second season of MASHLE, first season was great. Second season just picks up right where the first season leaves off, so it is a fantastic, a fantastic show as well. So, those are just a very few and far between series that I've actually gotten the chance to watch. And also, as you can see in the title of, I think that's how I'm actually going to put it, is we're going to talk a little bit about Silver Link. Almost said Soul Link again, but I swear, it's just every single time. I don't know why it is. It is actually just stupid. It is literally a level of stupid that I'm like, I'm not that dumb. Like, I actually see it and be like, oh yeah, it's Silver Link. It's Silver Link. Then I'll just say Soul Link for whatever reason. So I think we're just going to kind of go in order here and talk about some anime, you know, talk about these shows and particularly where I'm at with these shows. Let's talk with Solo Leveling. Solo Leveling, I think, is a fine show. For it being one of the Korean shows that are out right now, Korean that turned into anime, I think it's actually a relatively solid show. It is very pretty to look at. That is one thing for certain. It is one of the most prettiest looking animes I have ever seen. I don't say it's like one of the prettiest ones I've ever seen, but it's definitely up there. The animation, they go all out on it. So far, the story, I'm only like 3 episodes in. So with only being, you know, 3 episodes in, it kind of makes it a little bit hard to judge the show right now. It does have the mystery of the fact that what happens in episode 3, to where he is potentially might be dead, may not be dead. I am not 100% certain. It has definitely piqued my interest enough to keep moving. And the fact that to see how he actually winds up getting an ability that allows him to move up. Because the main guy is the he is the lowest of the low. And you can't go lower than him. But, you know, he's on one of his, not really one of his final jobs. But he's able to get an ability, and I'm kind of curious to see where this show is going to go with it. It could be very, as I said, this could be either really good and solidly on the season, because we're only getting, I'm not even sure on that, how many episodes we're actually going to be getting, because even they don't even know. But I think it's actually very much A1 Pictures really hit this out of the park, and I think it's very good. Frieren is still continuing to be Frieren. That show in particular is a fantastic show. If you've not started watching Frieren, I highly recommend it. This show is what I would consider is one of the best shows that came out last year and in continuing on to this year as well. Currently, right now, I am on episode 19, so I'm a little bit behind it because I think 20 just aired. I'm really looking forward to the show. The show is very, very solid, well-laid plans. Basically, episode 19 is just a continuation of Frieren just doing what Frieren does. Really looking at these characters and really letting us get to know some of these characters, whether or not these characters are going to die or not, you know, is eventually they'll be dead just because they kind of come and go in Frieren's life. And I really like the fact that it is a kind of a slice of life adventure fantasy series. I say slice of life, but it's not really truly slice of life. But the fact that, you know, she is going on these journeys with more journeys with other people. And I think this time around, when they went to defeat the Demon King, she's actually enjoying their company way more than what she did previously. Especially because with Heimdall, she is, you know, gotten to the point where she's just really regretted her decisions and everything else that, you know, she could have possibly done there. And I think it is something that this show is solid. I absolutely love the new season, the new opening for Frieren. The fact that we're only getting 28 episodes, I honestly think is definitely not enough. I'm looking forward to more of the show and also maybe finally getting to see the big guy, the guy that we're just, like, you know, going into actually seeing as well. So I'm really looking forward to the show. Also, the dub for the show is absolutely fantastic as well. So the writing is great. Everything about the show, you know, is done very, very well. So moving on to MASHLE. MASHLE is season 2 of MASHLE is, well, it is just doing what season 2 does. It's really what I expect from MASHLE altogether. It is a, what they would probably put it, like, oh yeah, it's a 2024 anime awards nominee. I mean, I could go over the anime awards and be like, I might actually do that here as well. So who knows? So what we've gotten so far through season 2 of MASHLE is fantastic. We're only 3 episodes in, and, you know, you get to see all these characters again, and the fact that MASHLE just being MASHLE is stupid, and I love it. It is the stupidity of it. It is the, you know, the Divine Visionary Candidate exam arc. For MASHLE, though, I don't know if it's still ongoing. It might be, though. Let's see here. There we go. This will help me out a lot. Thank you. Let's take a look here. Yes, it is done. It is 100% done right now. So it would not surprise me if this covers the entirety of the volumes, or it might be a few others after this season. The fact that it is fully 100% done, it can went from 2022 to 2023 in the manga. And dang it. I am looking forward to every one of these episodes. It is just a fantastic time. Also, if you've not seen season 2, or even if... just watch the opening for season 2. The opening for season 2 is fantastic opening. Oh my word, is it a fantastic opening. In one of the first episodes you see MASHLE, he's doing basically the Russian dance with a barbell. And I think that is just fantastic. That is just hilarious. It is just a really fun time, and that's really what this show truly is. It is just a fun, fun-filled time, and, you know, I'm really looking forward to seeing more from the show. Moving on here to The Wrong Way to Use Healing Magic is a very surprising isekai. Because as in the first episode, you have the main guy and his two friends, basically, that are the, you know, top of their class. You know, the girl wants to be isekai, to be like, oh yeah, you know, it'd be great if we go to another world. So they were, the two heroes are supposed to be who they were supposed to, you know, were supposed to be there. And their friend just kind of wound up getting tagged along because he was with them. And kind of gets brought in, and the fact that, you know, both of the heroes, you know, are able to use their, you know, standard magic, you know, their friend, however, he can be, who is someone there on accident, learns that he has, his magic is green, which is healing, but then also them being like, oh, please, we're gonna hide you now, and the reason why they're hiding him is because of the, is because of the trainer, the one who actually has healing magic, and healing magic is also very rare as well. But the fact that he has a teacher And she is an absolutely menace to society, and I love it. The fact that he goes through rigorous training in order to basically heal himself immediately, just immediately healing himself every, you know, all the time. And the fact that, like, he's going through this absurd training, and then all of a sudden, you know, when she finds him as well, is really funny, because she's like, okay, I'm going to take him, goodbye, and then basically takes him like a suitcase and just goes along the way and be like, yep, we'll be back. It is just a really great time, and it's a great twist on an isekai. I wasn't sure what we were going to get with this show, and it is not disappointed. Every single episode so far, I've only watched up to episode 3, but, you know, the first 3 episodes alone are just a great time. Absolutely great time. If you've not seen the show yet, I would highly recommend it, because, dang it, you will be having, you'll be having a good time watching this show. This show is definitely not what I would say the, it definitely doesn't hit a lot of the tropes that the isekais are in. And the fact that, you know, we're not really, the main character is not the character that's technically the hero, but he's there to be basically be support, but also he can take out a few people too. Also, you know, what, during his training, he also had to take out a bear as well. And potentially, you know, he also gets a, you know, something else to help him out as well. In the 3rd episode, he gets a bear to help him out. So, yeah, that is actually really fun. And, hey, who doesn't want to see you get, you know, go to battle on a bear? Okay? That's just metal. That's just great. With that being said, moving on to a show that is available on Hulu. Let's see here. I'm trying to think here now. Where are you? Is Undead Unluck? Undead Unluck is a fantastic show. If anybody who is around that, you were there for IkiCon this year, I was able to talk about Undead Unluck because I definitely put that in my top 10 anime of the year. And there is a good reason why. Because this show is just everything I really kind of want in a show, and it kind of ramps it up to an 11. So, in other words, the show itself allows me to, it really does, it goes with these characters, and really gets you to know these characters. Like, even in, like, the first, I would say, like, in episode, basically the first 3 episodes, they're able to get you, you know, used to a character that, Undead and Unluck are trying to take out, you know, take out characters so that way they can get their seat on the council. And it's kind of like almost like a Highlander situation where it's like, you know, there can only be, you know, 12 on that. And, and the fact that it's just, it's so great because you, there's a character that you don't want to see die because you, we actually get to learn about the character and actually get to see the character. And we really kind of feel for the character, the fact that, like, the fact that she potentially has to die in order to move on, in order for, you know, Undead and Unluck to be able to come in there, is just a fantastic, oh my god, it's so good, because it really gets you to know some of these characters, even some of these one-off characters, like a zombie. It really gets you to care about a zombie. It really makes you care about, like, all these different characters. It is so good at what it does. And also the fact that Undead, every time he, you know, has to regenerate, you know, the guy that made the manga itself has the drawn, you know, as if he has, like, a little bit, like, where his lung would be, is all, like, flagged out and erased out and everything. It is just a hilarious thing as well. Also, I would say the other thing I actually really like about it, as is really good, is that the comedy is on point in the show. Between Undead and Unluck, it is just the first time that you meet Unluck is she is trying to end her life because, you know, she has nothing else left to do, because, and no matter what she does, she brings unluck to people, because if people touch her, they become unlucky, they potentially could die. And the more that she cares, the more, you know, the more a disaster can, you know, will happen. And the fact that, you know, she may have accidentally killed her parents and, you know, different things when becoming, unluck. And the fact that, you know, Undead sees her as an opportunity to be like, oh, I might be able to finally die because this guy's been around for a while. And the fact that, you know, I think it's like an episode, I think it might be an episode 2 as well. Is that they get... No, I think it's in episode 1 where they get the... an episode, either 1 or 2, where they get brought in trying to, you know, into a company thing for the thing. I don't know. The name of the thing is very much a... UMA. No. Is it UMA? It's something I can't think of at this point in time. Yay. But for the company that wants to bring them in because either A, to study them or B, to kill them, is she winds up kissing him to bring down a meteorite down. And he's like, oh boy, what's what happens when you kiss? What happens if we did it? And she gets all flustered, goes, no, 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 runs off. And he's like, yeah, come here. It is great. As much as this guy might be a little bit on the rapey side, he does not do that. He is definitely like a guy that'd be like, no, I don't want to be the reason why, like, I don't want to be the reason why you, why we did it is because it's like, oh, you feel like you're forced into it. No, he just wants, you know, like the fact that you'd actually like me and that we, you know, all that fun stuff. So yeah, no, Undead Unluck is a fantastic show. Even going into episode 15 is where I'm at now. We find out that certain things happened with Unrepair. They thought they might have potentially killed him, and then all of a sudden he might be back. And they do actually have the 13th member as well in this new episode as well. This show has yet to disappoint me, and I don't think it will, because it is just a... It is another great continuation from the 2023 season into 2024, so definitely if you've not seen it, I highly recommend it. Moving on to another show, which is really funny that I think the one series thing I haven't actually used at all is that much is High Dive. There hasn't been a lot of really good High Dive shows that I'm like, yeah, like that I'm really like wigging into. And most of it's been Crunchyroll or Netflix or Hulu. And that's pretty much where most of the, you know, really good shows have been. And moving on to Villainess Level 99. I may be the hidden boss, but I'm not the Demon Lord. Is another fantastic show where you get reincarnated into a game. And so she becomes the hidden boss of the game that she actually used to play. And so she decides to be like, okay, you know what? I'm just gonna, you know, try to be in the background, just kind of just relax. I don't want to deal with, you know, I just want to get through the school and all that stuff, not have to be the, you know, killed by the one person that can potentially kill her. And, you know, so she decides to go to kill monsters and, you know, do this for about 15 years. And so everyone at the school's around, you know, level 5, 1, very, very low in level. Like, I would say the biggest person was 10. And then all of a sudden, she comes up and goes, oh, I'm level 99. Oh, I'm that high. And the fact that the teachers are like, oh, what? This must be bugged. Okay, let's get another one. And, okay, there's no way you're actually level 99. And the fact that she has to prove that she is level 99, and she has, like, all the people that she wants to avoid, she can't avoid at all because, you know, all of them want her at this point. Not really want her, but none of the heroes in the game that she was in want anything to do with her, but they also be like, she's like, oh, hey, look, the protagonist is right over there. And, you know, wind up seeing her, you know, meeting up with everybody earlier. And then even in the last episode that I watched for episode 3 has been a great time as well, because the fact that she's like, oh yeah, I know how to, she gets invited because everyone is, you know, she gets accepted because she also gets, you know, summoned to the king and queen. Because the reason why is that she had to prove the fact that through magic that she was level 99. So she's like, okay, I'm going to create a vortex up in the sky. And creates that vortex up in the sky. And, well, yeah. And everyone, you know, to prove that she's level 99. Well, of course, the king and queen want her in their corner. And they really want her to be the guy that's like, oh, yeah. They just want her to be the, I forget what it's called here. Yeah, they just want them on her side. So it's like, hey, you know, you could marry the prince. And she's like, no, I don't want to marry the prince. I don't want to. I just want to be left alone, basically, in all intents and purposes. Well, the one girl that really, really likes the prince, all of a sudden she is going after the main chick because of the fact that she wants to know, like, hey, are you, you know, we can be friends, but if you go after the prince, I, you know, be like, I don't want him. I've said I didn't want him because she even meets with the queen. And she tells him the same, tells her the same thing, be like, I don't want, you know, to marry your son, you know, marry the prince. And the one girl that wants to marry the prince, you know, is just, you know. So I'm assuming they're just going to become, you know, besties. Also, it's in the final, not the final, but the end credits is that you have them, you know, doing their little thing, which is, I actually really like the ending song for this show as well. It is just a fantastic show. I've been having fun watching the show. I think you will, if you've not seen the show, I think you will definitely like the show as well. It is a fantastic, absolutely fantastic show. So, moving on to the Undead, the Unwanted Undead Adventurer. So you have, I'm trying to think of the name of here, Rent, who has hunted monsters for the last 10 years. And he's not great at his job, you know, stuck hunting slimes and goblins for a few coins each day. His luck turns when he finds an undiscovered pathway. At the pathway's end, he meets his demise in the maw of a legendary dragon. But he does come back as a, what do you call it, as a skeleton. And, you know, he gets to be like, oh, he has all of his memories. And then becomes a, he goes from being a, you know, baby, basically going up the, after he is able to beat the skeleton, all of a sudden he's able to actually, all of his abilities get amplified. And he can actually use everything he, you know, is able to use, even divine. All of the spells he's able to use, and actually becomes stronger than he was as an adventurer. But he also becomes, after he's been there for, been down there for a little bit, killing slime and skeletons, he actually gets, and basically goes up the existential evolution, and goes up to become a ghoul. So I think for the evolution, he wants to become a vampire. But we also see his, the fact that he actually also has to deal with the thing that he is, actively a ghoul. And is he just, you know, is he the Rent that he was as an adventurer? Or was as a monster, is he now, you know, actually different in a way where, can he actually be with society? Can he actually deal with all that stuff as well? And, you know, I really like the fact that what they're kind of asking these questions on, you know, because he technically died, but then came back, but he has all of his memories as Rent, and, you know, before he was an adventurer. And so I don't know if he actually is going to become a, whether or not, you know, he's going to be able to have to deal with the fact that, like, the first time he sees blood, he wants, you know, he all of a sudden is like, oh, hey, has an urge to eat, wants to eat the guy that he's, you know, trying to help out. And it is one of those shows where I think it's going to be a lot of fun. And yeah, so I'm definitely looking forward to more from the show. Yeah, so does a lot of really cool stuff. So yeah, with that being said, we're moving on to the next show. And that is Delicious in Dungeon. It is the Netflix show this year, and darn it, Delicious in Dungeon is just a great time. No, please stop, there we go. Uh-oh. I did not want to do that. I want to do this. Haha, thank you. So I've watched the first few episodes of this show, and it has been a fun-filled time. Studio Trigger has done a great job with this show. This is definitely a Trigger-esque show, and the fact that this is their, you know, I would say 12th or 13th show that they've done in their entire existence, which is insane to think about, because you look at other shows like MAPPA and Silverlink have been around almost around the same time. MAPPA has actually been around a little bit longer than about around the same time as Trigger in 2011, and they have way more shows under their belt. But because Trigger tends to do more original stuff, and this is actually not one of their more originals, I think this show is absolutely a fantastic time, because it's about all about hunting, basically being in the dungeon and having to eat and eating monsters and learning how to, you know, eat some of these monsters and be like, oh, we can eat these. Even into the last episode 3, where it's like living armor, you can eat the armor because it's like, oh yeah, they're like shells that are in the armor. It is, you know, absolutely fantastic, and I really quite enjoy it. It is just an absolutely great, you know, it is an absolute great time in this show. I've really quite enjoyed it. The fact that also they only have a month to save his sister from a dragon who's being eaten, and before she is fully digested. So, you know, they have a little bit of time before they have to go get her, but they kind of have to move at a you know, at an actual pace. But the plus side is, this is only 24 episodes in length. I believe all of Delicious in Dungeon is out. So I believe we're going to get the entirety of this series in 24 episodes. And if the first three episodes are anything to think about, it is going to be great. It is going to be a fun filled time, especially because you have an elf that's with them who is very reluctant to eat any of the monsters and be like, I just want real food. I just want real food. And basically having to eat monster, but like, oh, these are really good though. But there's some touches in here that I absolutely really like that Studio Trigger does show. There's a dwarf that's with them who basically at one scene that, you know, he's just they're kind of talking, but he's also cleaning his pots and pans. It is just a great detail that, you know, that tends to go away, and it is just a fun filled show. If you've not seen it, I highly recommend this show. This show is one of my personal favorites from this season. I don't know if it's actually the favorite from the season. Looking back at it, especially not including Frieren, not including Undead, Unluck, anything that came out from last year, I wouldn't be including them that. But it's definitely in the top, I would say definitely in the top five. If not, it definitely up there. I'm not sure exactly who actually wins out with this show, because this season, because dang it, there's a lot of really good shows that came out and it's only winter right now, which is kind of insane to think about. So the other show that we're going to talk about here is Hokkaido Gals Are Super Adorable. Is another really fun filled show. The dub on it is great, because the fact that they do have what's her face, of course, I can't remember her name, but the lead chick, they have her in a Canadian Midwestern voice, and it is actually quite great, because it's like a boot, you know, just like the, whatever it is, the old Midwestern feel to it, and Canadian Midwestern, I mean, what's the difference really? some Canadians will be like, oh, we're different than, we're different, eh? We're totally different, but, what I watched in the first episode of the dub is fantastic. Also, going into the third episode, the first three episodes, I've really quite enjoyed them. They're just a really great time. And again, this is Silverlink being, well, Silverlink, and is able to just do what they do. And so one thing I will say about Silverlink, and anytime they get a series, they go hard in the paint with the series. They actually really do a great job at translating a series over from the manga into an anime form, And that's something that I think is a great strength of Silverlink. And even a series that might be not great, if a manga is getting animated by Silverlink, it'll be an absolutely fantastic. Like, the animation will be absolutely fantastic. And even him learning about the, seeing the new, one of the girls that's there, and the fact that, Akino, the one that basically he was like, oh yeah, super unfriendly, and they find out, oh, you know, she's just kind of, she's a gamer, but also, you know, the one thing that, you know, most guys be like, oh wow, they do exist. A girl gamer? What? No. But, it is just a fantastic, with them learning how to ski, and I think one of the guys I was actually watching this with was saying, like, I hate skiing. Skiing is annoying, you know, is just annoying. It is just, you know, not a fun time at all. But I really quite enjoyed Hokkaido Gals are super adorable. I think Silverlink is just absolutely a weird company, because everything they make is very, for the most part, is very well done. It's animated well, and the story itself is dependent on, is definitely going to be dependent on the manga. It's going to be dependent from story to story on whether or not you particularly like it, but they do not skimp out, and they do stuff very, very well for, being able to do stuff for money and everything. So it's like, it is just a fantastic time. If you've not seen the show, I highly recommend it. Even a lot of Silverlink shows, I would say, you know, I would highly recommend. Because they are a company that definitely makes a lot of different shows. So, speaking of which, talking about Silverlink again, because we can kind of go into it with this one, is, Sasaki, yeah, wow, Sasaki and, Peeps is another show that by Silverlink, and they have two shows out that I actively think that they are very good. But this one, I think, is their better show. It is definitely one of their better ones. Sasaki and Peeps is about a guy that's just a salaryman guy that, you know, it starts off him, you know, basically being, like, kind of sad that he doesn't have a pet. He wants a pet, you know, wants a cat, and, you know, winds up going with a bird saying, hey, what about me? What about me? And, you know, he's like, oh, okay, you know, why not? And he finds out that he winds up with a talking bird, who got reincarnated from a fantasy world. And then, so basically, he gets isekai'd. And not really isekai'd, but he gets brought into that world. And he's able to, you know, use his business connections and start, you know, trading with some of the stuff that we have in this world versus the fantasy world. And also within... He also winds up in the same episode, mind you, winds up getting stuck in with the psychics as well, and having to work with the psychics, because he knows spells, and basically they mistake the spell for the psychics, for being a psychic, and only able to, you know, he has to, basically, oh, I can only do ice, and also the show might have a magical girl at some point in time. So I have no idea. This show is all over the place, and it's fantastic for it. It jumbles a lot of different... it juggles a lot of different... I would say, in and of itself, the type of show, whether you want to go from the isekai or psychic route, both shows could be their own show in and of itself, but this show blends it very well and is able to juggle both into the plot. That's just like, it is just a fantastic, absolutely fantastic time. I've really quite enjoyed it so far. It has been one of my, I think it could actually be one of the more best anime of the year. It's definitely up there. So definitely, if you've not seen the show, the third episode is, you know, potentially he gets winds up having to deal with a war in the fantasy life and having to deal with, juggle both the fantasy world, especially because he, you know, also owns a restaurant in that world, but also, you know, making some decent money on the side as well, going in between the two, and also having a really nice bed in the fantasy world and everything. And it's just, this guy just kind of wants to have like a chill, just wants to be just kind of a chill life, and doesn't really get that as much because, you know, he gets kind of taught, basically told, oh, by the way, you're joining the psychics for the special psychic force, and you have no say in it. So, okay, cool. And finding out his partner is also, you know, a young child. Not young, but like 16. And wears, you know, a ton of makeup and everything. But I will say this show is absolutely a fantastic show. If you've not seen it, I can't highly recommend it enough. And then moving on to one of the, honestly, it might be one of the more underrated stuff. Some of the ones I'm talking about now are actually probably the more underrated shows. And that is Seventh Time Loop, the Villainess Enjoys a Carefree Life Married to Her Worst Enemy. And it's all about being basically kind of reincarnated back in time. So we get to see all of her different lives. For her first life, she was able to be a traitor. And kind of like seeing the life of, she was born into the life of a noble. And basically having to, oh no, my bad. She was a duke's daughter, and then having to basically be like, oh yeah, I am going to marry this prince, who winds up telling her that, you know, coming up with all of these stories that she, you know, that she did, and break off the engagement to go after another girl. And so her first life, she winds up getting disowned by her parents, having to basically be kicked off on the streets. So the first life, she winds up being a traitor, and then a war breaks out. She's being very successful at that. War breaks out, she dies. And then gets brought back into, all of a sudden gets sent back into time. And this happens multiple, basically six times. She's on their seventh time loop. And it all comes down to the last time that she was in there, she was a soldier. And she was trying to protect whoever was in the castle. And she basically, she gets killed by the guy that wants to marry her in the seventh time loop. And, you know, he sees her vaulting over in the second floor and basically saying like, oh, you know what? I haven't gone this way before. Let's see what happens when we go this way. And just vaults herself off the balcony and, you know, lands on the ground. He sees her and goes, whoa, that's my kind of lady, basically. And, yeah, so he's the guy that winds up killing her with the sword that he has. And, you know, we have that mystery of potentially, like, he's the reason why she has died six times beforehand. And they're finally going on to the seventh, you know, this is the seventh time. And he basically tells her, hey, I want to marry you. And she basically tells him no at the beginning. And then, you know, he doesn't really take no as an answer, and then she goes, you know, I will have these requests, you know, you can't touch me, blah, 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 blah. And, he, you know, he accepts all those requests, even as selfish as it is. One thing I will say about the show is very pretty. It's a very pretty show to look at. The light refracting off the hair is just a fantastic, it looks so good. The show itself, I've really quite enjoyed, especially because she has all of her, you know, memories from her past lives, where she was a maid, she was, you know, a soldier, she was a trader, and really trying to set the trading company that she was with that first started, that, you know, apart, especially in the last episode, because she got to finally choose her maids, and of course, it'd be like, oh yeah, you know, it's like, we were kind of all just having fun with it, and be like, ah, it is I, the maid, that the person that was saying, like, yeah, oh, that person's not here. That was just chilling out, you know. It is great. The animation of this show is fantastic from, you know, absolute start to finish. There was a lot of money put into the show, and it really shows. It really pays off a dividend on this show altogether. It is a absolutely fantastic show. Now, another show that I was talking about here that's a little bit on the end is Dr. Elise, the Royal Lady with the Lamp. And with this being, this is the other Korean show that came in from Korea, made it to Japan, and I look at the show and I go, yeah, it's not bad. The first episode, I was not a big fan of. By episode 3, I think it'll suck you in, because you get to see the fact that, like, in her past life, she was not a great, you know, not a great person, gets reincarnated into a different person, and just reincarnated into, you know, a person that is a, what is the word I'm looking for here? is an orphan, and having to deal with, you know, not coming from royalty, and the fact that she died at the stake, it's just like, okay, you know what? In this life, I'm going to help as many people as I can. So she becomes a doctor to help as many people as she can. By the end of the first episode, she winds up dying after a plane crash, but after taking care of all these people, and saving so many lives before she, you know, winds up dying. And then she dies and then gets reincarnated, sent back into her old life. But she uses some of the, for medical terms and everything else that she knows, she's able to, you know, diagnose, because you could basically, I think it's technically back in time, I believe. And, yeah, back in time before she, wow, that literally was something, huh. But, she definitely was a, wow, I don't even know what I'm doing here anymore. That's always fun. she goes back into her, you know, in the old life, and then she's able to help with to say, hey, I don't want to marry the prince because it's not a good idea, because the fact that he was kind of just marrying her because of, you know, they have to or whatnot. And the fact that she's just trying to help people as much as possible. Also, within the third, you know, she gets sent to a doctor and be like, okay, you know what? Fine. She's able to do certain terminologies that is like, yeah, you know, whatever, you know, you're going to last like maybe a day, 3 days at tops. And within her first little bit of being there, she cleans the facility, you know, makes it really nice for the patients, but also does surgery in the room as well, and does it very successfully. And it's like, one of those things where it's like, oh, okay. Dr. Kitty Diesel, it's a little bit mad at her because he's saying to her that, hey, who did the surgery? She said, I did. Like, what doctor helped you? It was just me. And, you know, because she has multiple years of experience. So she has about, I would say, I don't even know if it's like 10 years of experience. It's something of experience, but she's a very, you know, well-known doctor that is able to do multiple different surgeries. And, you know, she takes those knowledges back with her there in helping treating patients and learning, basically, kind of ish learning how to become a doctor, because technically she's got more knowledge, medical knowledge, than, because she's from the technically future here, I believe. So she knows of more things like diabetes, all these different things. So it's like, so it is one of those things where it's like, I look at it and go, yeah, I think it's a fantastic, it is a fantastic show. It definitely hits its stride at around the third episode, is really where it hits the ground running. So if you can stick with it the first two episodes, I think you will be very pleasantly surprised that this show will actually do a lot more than you think it will. Moving on to a show that I honestly was kind of looking forward to, but I'm looking at it right now and I'm kind of going like, it is okay. It's an okay show, but it's also proof that a show doesn't, it could be making a lot of, like, it could be very, very well done. The animation of the show is very well done. Metallic Rouge is, I think of the show is, animation-wise, fantastic show. For the original coming from Bones, I am not a big fan of this show. I think this show is, it looks very pretty, but only in between the first two episodes, it kind of feels like these characters, yeah, we're trying to figure out, you know, what's going on with Rouge and with Neon. Rouge, who's a Neon, and Naomi had to track down had, you know, tracking some people down, but... And Rouge, you know, apparently just really likes chocolate as well, but I look at the show and go... comparing it to, you know, some of these other shows that I've been watching, I'm like, this show is just okay. It is not going to win any type of awards. Some people might be like, oh yeah, this show is really good. Metallic Rouge is a absolutely fantastic show. And be like, yeah, it's one of the best shows I've watched all year. And it's kind of is that issue of just like, the story is just kind of meh. I would say this is one where Bones kind of missed the mark on it so far. I could be wrong on it and be like, absolutely eat everything and having something there. Like, I really want the show to have something because I really enjoy Bones and I really enjoy what they do. But, like, there are a ton of Bones shows that I've really quite enjoyed, like Full Metal Alchemist. Now, granted, the original stuff, I'm not exactly sure what original stuff they've done. That'd be like, oh yeah, Refexion, Wolf's Rain, not a big fan of Wolf's Rain, but you know, that's just the whole thing there. I'm trying to look through some of the stuff that they've done that's original that I've actually watched, and crap, this is not helping. This is not helping because when most of the stuff I've seen of their stuff is not the original stuff. But I know Ref Axion is actually relatively well-liked as being a very good show. Coffin Princess Will is a light novel. That's a manga. Oh my goodness. Is there anything that's not actually considered off of manga? That their original stuff that I'm like, I've actually seen. Okay, Carolyn Tuesday is another one of their original stories. And I actually really like Carolyn Tuesday. The ending of Carolyn Tuesday is not as good, but I think it's solid overall. So there's some stuff that they've done that's original. Also, Skate the Infinity is also another great original show that they've done. This one right here, Skate the Infinity, at least has the feel of it being a... It at least feels like it is... It's got a great visuals, but it's also got a really interesting story. This show in particular just has no story. It feels like it's just kind of going around doing its thing and not being very good all at the same time. I am not a big fan of this show. I will continue to watch the show to potentially maybe see the fact that I might be wrong on it. But right now... I'm kind of hoping it only has 12 episodes, because that's all this should get. Even though it looks like a lot of money were thrown into the show, it's definitely proof that a lot of money thrown into a show doesn't mean that the show is going to be good. It doesn't automatically mean the show is going to be, you know, a great hit and it's going to be fantastic, because some of these other shows that I've watched are way better than this one. There could be other shows that you could be watching here. If you have some time, check out the 3 episodes. You might enjoy it, you might not, but as of right now, I've honestly not really quite enjoyed the show at all. And talking about the final show that we've watched this week was Mr. Villain's Day Off. Unlike the Moulin Rouge, this show has a lot of heart to it. Mr. Villain's Day Off is all about, you know, a supervillain that is trying to fight the power, basically the Super Sentai. And on his days off, he goes and sees the pandas at the zoo, because, you know, that's as one does. But, you know, and not wanting to have a really bad work, having a work life, you know, being able to have a work life balance, you know, he's able to, you know, balance it out with work and everything else by saying, you know, every time it's his day, it's my day off, I don't want to work. So you see run into Red a few times, and he's like, Red's about ready to fight him. And he's like, no, this is my day off, we're truce. He also really loves pandas as well. And it's just a great comedy that is just a great slice of life comedy of him just kind of doing his thing. We see him at work and going like, oh man. There are some times where you look at it and go, yeah, I feel that. Because sometimes I go into work and I'm like, I should have taken the day off. It's just that kind of a day. And it is just so fantastic. And I absolutely just really like it. And it is just a great, great grand old time. So if you've not seen Mr. Villain's Day Off, I can't recommend this show enough. More than enough here. Because this show is just... If you want to watch a guy, especially because I really want one of the Rangers as well to be like one of the, you know, two little kids in a trench coat Ranger. Why? Because I think it would be really, really funny. But seeing the fact that like how he, you know, is able to, okay, I'm going to work up because there was a bun for a panda bun in the third episode. And it is quite funny watching him go, okay, I'm going to work up to this panda. And just getting all these meat buns and these different type of buns. And he's like, all right, we're going to work up to it, work up to it. And then all of a sudden, right as he's about ready to buy it, he's like, oh, that's, oh, they it's out of season at that point. And he's like, oh, darn it. And I really quite enjoy it. I mean, there's also him learning about, you know, rabbits and having to be like, oh, these things are so adorable. It's so good. This show is a fantastic show. If you've not watched it right now, we currently only have seen the Red Ranger and Blue Ranger. We have not seen the Pink. Not sure if technically the two small children are another Ranger. We're not 100% on that, but it is really great. My goodness, this is so good. So fantastic. So, with that being said... There is another series that there is another thing that we could talk about here a little bit. And let's talk about Silverlink in general. Silverlink is a company that was founded in 2007. And boy, have they done anime. And I'm looking to do the ups and downs of Silverlink. And I think the studio is a very interesting studio because since 2007, they have done an insane amount of anime. And I mean an insane amount of anime. Because most every year, they usually do around like 5 to 6, or like between, I would say between 4 and 5 anime a year. Which for a studio, for one studio alone, is in an absolutely insane amount. But the fact that you actually get very quality animation from them, with that amount of anime going on, is absolutely surprising. It's very, very surprising. So one of the animes we're going to talk about here is Tayutama, Kiss on My Deity. This show is not great. Is definitely their first show of, it is, I would say, their first show that they ever produced. And it is off of a VN. And most of the time when you see VNs, is a visual novel, it's usually not great. You do actually have some of those series that are very good, Clannad definitely being one of them. But this one is just your kind of typical what you would expect in 2007 anime. It just kind of like, oh yeah, the main chick is just, it's a cute girl, and she's kind of doing her thing, and it's fine all the way through. It's just okay. The Tatsumi and Kiss My, on My Deity is just, honestly, it's just an okay series. It's not one of my favorites. It's definitely low. It's definitely just really low on the scale of like what Silverlink has actually done. And with that being said, Silverlink did another series, because Tatsumi and Kiss My Deity, I would say probably one of the worst, not one of their worst shows they've done. It's definitely not a good, like, I don't know if it's a good way to, like, open it up with what Silverlink has actually done. They've done a lot of fantastic shows. Baka and Test, Summon the Beasts, is an absolutely fantastic show. I have watched all of it. I have watched the OVA, I have watched season 1 and season 2. Of that show, I was cracking up laughing the entire time. This is what Silverlink is very good at. Silverlink is really great at doing comedy. And comedy is something that I don't know, you look at different companies and be like, okay, yeah, a company like A1, I think, can do comedy very well. But Civil League has a very unique perspective when it comes to it. Is like their comedy is on a almost on another level when it comes to that. Also, their as I said, like their animation quality, Kisame Deity is another show that's fantastically. I think it's a very animated, very well for what it is, and you know, for it being 2009 and what you kind of expect from a 2009 style. You know, the style, the card, the animation style, and everything else. One thing I will say, this show, Civil League does not do a whole lot of original stuff, which honestly I think is okay. It is very okay for a studio to just really mostly do non-original stuff, because you have something like Trigger that almost only does original, you know, original stories, original characters, because, you know, I really like a lot of Trigger's styles and what they look like. So because of the fact that Silver Link tends to all do all these animation anime, they don't do a lot of original stories, but they do based off of light novels, based off of manga and all that stuff. There's already characters designed. They already have those type of characters in there, and they're really not going to try to add on to these characters. But what they are going to do is animate it very, very well and give us a great story on, you know, and give a great adaptation. Like, they're very good at adaptations. They are what I would consider an elite adaptation when it comes to what they actually do and the amounts that they've done. Baka and Test is hilarious from start to finish. It's about a Yoshi, the Baka of the title. He's an idiot, which, you know, of course, Baka means idiot. Basically, idiot and Test, some of the beasts. He is the worst student in the class, but he is also considered an ambitionary, you know, because he's so bad at it. He is a student that has, he's able to actually, while the other people's avatars are not able to do anything in the real world, he, you know, gets used by teachers all the time in order to be able to, do minuscule tasks or something like that. And it is a great time, especially because he has two girls that are, you know, apparently fawning over him. Not really fawning, but one of the girls that really likes him, you know, treats him horrible. But, you know, hey, he treats him like one of the guys. And, of course, they have the running gag on one of the guy characters that basically saying, like, I'm a guy. Like, saying, like, there's three girls in here. There's four girls. Stop it. But it's like, I'm one of the guys. Who are you counting on? You know, it's just a fantastic show. Yeah, so it's like they're all in in the F class. And it is just an absolutely fun-filled time. If you've not seen the Bakken Test, it's available on Crunchyroll. All the seasons, including the OVA. Yeah, so including all of the OVAs and everything else, is available on Crunchyroll. So definitely check those out. Those are really, really going to be worth your time as well. As I said, like, I've watched a few other shows from this company as well. And I will say that, well, C-Cubed is another show that I've been currently watching. And the first three episodes, yeah, it's very much an ecchi type of show. But again, it gives you a relatively, I would say, a very good adaptation, or at least from what I can tell, of an adaptation of the light novel there. Because I could actually go through and check to see, you know, what is the source, like, what is their more original stuff versus what's their non-original. But, like, you go through their stuff, like, Strike the Witches, they did some original-ish stuff with Strike the Witches. But I think Strike the Witches is also based off some other stuff as well. Bonjour, Sweet Love, Prosite is a short-form series that's also original from them. And I definitely will say that this will be a show that you were going to see most of their original stuff based on, you know, is based on something else. Is either based on a, you know, properties or anything like that. Like, I think that's the only other one I could think of there that was like, oh yeah, no, this is not based on anything here. And it kind of is. A Brave Witch is another one that technically is more original, but it's also a spinoff of Strike the Witches. So yeah. Which is really funny to me that this is also from the same company of Shaft as well. That you would think that I would not be a big fan of a lot of stuff that, you know, Shaft does. Now, I will say, Kiss on My Deity and Baka and Test do have some of these weird... Kiss on My Deity actually tends to have more of it. Baka and Test, I don't think, does. Not nearly as much of the Shaft look of, oh, we're going to have these weird type of angles, which I think by Baka and Test, they actually stopped doing that entirely. So they kind of get away from their Shaft approaches of being just overly artistic. And I'm not a big fan of that. I'm not a big fan of the overly artistic type of show that's like, oh yeah, beautiful shot. No character. I mean, don't get me wrong. A lot of Shaft shows are very well loved. Monogatari series, very well loved. But Silver Link is a very, it's a very interesting show, a very interesting company because of the fact that they, that they actually, you know, we were talking about two shows from them today and then technically three more. With very, very small looking at Baka and Test. C-Cubed, I think, is going to be one I'm probably going to watch as we're going. So I'll probably, you know, look at that as, you know, anime we watch today. And yeah, so with that being said, guys, thank you guys so much for watching and listening here. I know that sometimes, hopefully you guys quite enjoyed it. I know sometimes I can actually quite ramble on, and hopefully this was a lot of fun to listen to. And hopefully you guys had a lot of fun listening. And we can bring you more of this stuff. And I'm hoping this can be, you know, very much more weekly with this show and for the anime podcast. So thank you guys so much for watching. And as always, I'm Zain, and I'll see you guys on the flip side.